So here is the solution. The boy has taken 1 plus 2 plus 3 up to 97, 98, 99, and 100. What the boy has done, 1 plus 100. He got the value as 101. Then he took from the beginning second number and from the last second number. So that is again gave him 101. Then again 3 and 98, 4 and 97, 5 and 96, and so on. So each sum is 101. So like that, as there are 100 numbers, it will be divided into 50 pairs. Therefore, the sum is 50 50. This was the approach the boy has followed. Today, we are going to talk about the law framed by the same boy. He is none other than Gauss. Gauss was a child prodigy, is a genius of mathematics, contributed a lot to the mathematics and physics. You will come to know by comparing a numerical which is solved by using Coulomb's law and using Gauss law. So using Coulomb's law, it takes suppose some 5 to 6 minutes. Using Gauss law, it takes hardly 1 to 2 minutes. That is the intelligence of Gauss. Anyway, Gauss law has got some limitations also. Now, in this lecture today, I'll first tell you the statement of the Gauss law. Later on, for a known situation, I'll prove it, and thereafter, we apply the Gauss law for different situations. Now, let me begin with the statement of Gauss law. The Gauss law states that the total flux passing through the area is 1 by epsilon naught times of the charge enclosed by the surface. Q in, I'll write. This Q in is nothing but the charge enclosed within the surface. The total charge. Charge enclosed by the surface. This charge indicates net charge. Now, in the last class, we talked about the flux, electric flux. The electric flux d phi is equal to E dot ds. If n cap is the unit vector of the area vector, remember to involve the orientation, we have made the area as vector and we have given the direction of area as outward normal. We have had enough discussion with regard to the electric flux. So we have written d phi is equal to E dot ds. Now, if you want to know the total flux, integral over E dot ds. Here, this is a new sign for you. It is simple integration. If you keep one circle over it, it is surface integral or closed integral. So, Gauss law is applicable for closed surfaces. Phi, which is equal to integral over E dot ds, in turn, it will be equal to 1 by epsilon naught times of the charge enclosed by the surface. So, this is the simple form of mathematical form of Gauss law. It has got lot of importance in electrostatics. So, the flux, that is phi, passing through the area is equal to 1 by epsilon naught times of Q in, where this Q is representing the net charge enclosed by the surface. Now, suppose if any area consists of plus Q, minus 2Q, plus 3Q, and so on. So, if three charges are there, what is the flux passing through this? You have to take the net charge, plus 3, plus 1, 4, minus 2. So, finally, plus 2Q by epsilon naught is the electric flux coming out of that surface. Then what should be the flux? Dipole, if you remember, dipole is nothing but the arrangement of one positive and the other negative of equal and opposite charges placed very close to each other. Now, if a dipole is placed in a surface, then what is the flux coming out of it? So, straight away the answer would be 0. Why? Because the charge is additive. Here plus Q and minus Q combine together to give you 0. Therefore, no flux will be there. So, Gauss law should be understood properly, and then if you once understand it properly, then you can apply the Gauss law for the any kind of situation. So, how to verify the Gauss law? So, Gauss law says E dot ds closed integral over E dot ds is always equal to 1 by epsilon naught times of charge enclosed in it. E dot ds, which tells me integral over, because we know that A dot B is equal to AB cos theta. Here E dot ds means E ds cos theta. Now we know at that particular point on the sphere is the electric field is Q by 4 pi epsilon naught r square. So, for this E, I have substituted. Now, this is ds cos theta. Now, if I write the terms conveniently, this r square I have written with ds cos theta by r square. So, if you remember well, when we talked about the solid angle, we said that it is the projection of area divided by r square. So that is nothing but ds cos theta by r square. So now ds cos theta by r square can be replaced by d omega q by 4 pi epsilon naught d omega. Now here q is constant, so I can take it out, and epsilon 4 pi epsilon naught, these are all constants only, so I can keep it outside, and only variable for me is d omega. But d omega for the entire sphere is 4 pi integral over d omega for any closed surface is 4 pi. We have had enough discussion for this solid angle also. On the other day when I was discussing this solid angle concept, so if you take different cones, place one over the other, finally it will be ended up with a sphere. And if you consider that this is one small d omega, then by the other cone d omega 2, d omega 3, and if you add all, then it gives you 4 pi as the net answer for the solid angle. So the solid angle for the sphere is 4 pi. For any closed surface it is 4 pi, not only for the sphere. Now what we do, q by 4 pi epsilon naught times 4 pi, which gives me q by epsilon naught. So if you see this, we began with writing the left hand portion of Gauss law. What is left hand portion of Gauss law? Integral over E dot ds. And we have written the meaning of it. A dot B is equal to AB cos theta. So E ds cos theta. Now E, we know that if you take a small point charge here Q at a distance R, it will be Q by 4 pi epsilon naught R square. That's why we took E ds cos theta. And then ds cos theta by R square is nothing but d omega, and for any closed surface d omega is 4 pi. So according to the definition of solid angle, d omega is equal to ds cos theta by r square. So in that way we have ended up with the 1 by epsilon r times of Q. So this is the verification of Gauss law. Remember, we first stated the total flux passing through the area is always equal to 1 by epsilon naught times of charge enclosed by the surface. The charge indicates that it is net charge. Okay, so charge is additive. So we took some examples and we discussed what is the meaning of net charge and what would be the flux for different charges placed in a surface. Now we have to study the applications of Gauss law. The very first application, the electric field due to a linear charged rod. First application is this. Remember, to apply the Gauss law, the following steps are to be followed. One, you have to imagine a Gaussian surface. Again, what do you understand by Gaussian surface? It can be either a cylinder or a sphere normally. you have to imagine the Gaussian surface. How that Gaussian surface should be? It should be passing through the point of interest. Through the point of interest. That means where you wanted to calculate, that point should be covered by the Gaussian surface. Next, we should calculate for small area the flux passing through small area. Now we have to integrate it within the suitable limits. So these are the steps. Now we will follow these steps one after the other. The other convenience lies with the Gauss law. Suppose if the field is constant, if E is constant, straight away we can write E times A is equal to 1 by epsilon naught times of Q. E dot A can be straight away 1 by epsilon naught times of Q. You need not take small area and then integrate it. If it is a regular surface, if it is electric field is constant, then directly we will do this thing. We need not write integral over E dot ds, and we have to integrate it. We need not integrate in that particular case. And all the examples that are given and all the applications that are given in your NCERT textbook are of this kind only. So it is very easy for us. So first of all, we have to imagine a Gaussian sphere, and you have to see how many surfaces are there. You must know a little bit of the area of that particular shape. Suppose if area of circle is there, pi r square. If area of curved surface, area of cylinder is there, 2 pi r l, where l is the length of the cylinder. If it is sphere, 4 pi r square is the area. So these facts you must know, then you can do all these applications very easily. The very first step, we have to write the Gauss law, and after that we have to solve it. Let us begin with one example, which is electric field due to linear charged rod. So this is linear charged rod. Let us consider that it is having some positive charge on it. Now I wanted to get, this is my point of interest. I wanted to know what is the electric field at that particular point due to this charge distribution. If you want to apply the Coulomb's law for this, then you have to imagine one small charge, and then you have to see by applying one positive charge, by imagining one positive charge, this is the electric field direction. This is one small dE. Now you have to take that into components. Again, you have to take another strip. So then when you take all the components together, then suppose it is symmetrical one. Suppose if I take one small strip here, it will be like this dE. Then again dE cos theta, dE sin theta. So in all these cases, these horizontal components getting cancelled with each other, and then sin theta components are to be added, and then finally it should be integrated. But when you wanted to do with Gauss law, it is very simple, and you will get within three steps the answer. Let me tell you how to do with Gauss law. We took this linear charge density, linear charge rod, and our interest is, point of interest is P. At that point we wanted to calculate the electric field. Now I have to imagine a Gaussian surface. So for me, the Gaussian surface is a cylinder which is symmetrical about this line. This is radius of the cylinder, and this is the length of the cylinder. Now if you look at this figure, there are three areas. One is this circular area whose area vector outward normal. The other one is this curved surface area. This is the outward normal. Now the third is the other circle, which is A3. Now here I am interested at this particular point. So to know the electric field direction, what should I do? I have to imagine one positive charge here. When I imagine the positive charge, we know that as we have taken this positively charged rod, the electric field will be in this direction. Why? Because unit positive charge will be repelled by the charge distribution. Electric field for any surface, it is in this direction only. Now I hope that situation is clear for you. Suppose if I rub this straw and I am interested to know the electric field at one particular point above this, okay, so this is like this, okay. Now I have to imagine a Gaussian surface like this. So this is my cylindrical surface, and this cylindrical surface has got two circular areas and then one curved surface area. So these three are the areas for me, and then here if I consider the situation like this, this is the area vector, electric field vector, okay. Now you can easily see that this electric field vector is perpendicular to the area vector for the surface 1 and for the surface 3. If the two vectors are perpendicular to each other, what should be the dot product? It is obviously 0. E dot A, that is E A cos theta, when theta becomes 90, it becomes 0. The flux becomes 0. So therefore, now I have to write the Gauss law for it. What is the statement for Gauss law? E dot, I told you, when the area is a regular shaped area, directly we can apply the formula E dot A1. This is for the first surface. This is, I am calling it as first surface. And this is my second surface, curved surface. And this is the third. So first surface plus E dot A2 plus E dot A3. According to Gauss law, this all should be equal to 1 by epsilon naught times of the charge enclosed. So this is my charge enclosed by the cylinder. Now E dot A1 is E A1 cos 90. This A2, if you look at these two vectors, they are making 0 degrees with each other, rather they are parallel. Therefore, E A2 cos 0. Then again, third one, E A3 cos 90. Of course, I have to take the vector signs like this for all. Now, I can make this as 0, this also as 0, but here I must write E times 2 pi R L. So this is all equal to 1 by epsilon naught times of charge enclosed within it. So charge in. So this is equal to 1 by epsilon naught Q in. Now if I wanted to know E, then 1 by this 2 pi R L term will come here, 2 pi epsilon naught R Q by L. If you remember, we have defined the linear charge density as lambda. So this is Q by L. So the final answer will be lambda by 2 pi epsilon naught R. So this is the first application of Gauss law. Now if you look at this result, here E is inversely proportional to R. Why? Because lambda is constant. This is lambda means the net charge per unit length. So if you take the total charge by total length, or if you take small charge by its length, the length on which it is there, that should be remaining same. Okay, it is uniformly linear charged rod. Therefore, E is directly proportional to 1 by R, or E is inversely proportional to R. Now, if I draw a graph between the electric field versus the distance from the axis of cylinder, then I'll get a graph like this. That is, if R is lesser, the electric field is more. If R is increasing, the electric field is decreasing. And this will be parallel to this x-axis, because electric field tends to zero only when R tends to infinity. That's why we should not touch this curve with the x-axis. So this is the first application. In this, we have simply taken the Gaussian surface. As we have taken cylinder, there are three types of surfaces: two circular areas and then one curved surface area. And then by seeing the electric field vector, because area vectors are already known to us, only we have to see the electric field vector. By seeing electric field vector, we could come to know whether the angle between the electric field and the area is zero, or the angle between the electric field and area is 90. If electric field and area makes 90 degrees with each other, that is, no flux passes through this one. So what does it indicate? If I take one linear charged rod like this, the electric flux passes either upward or in the downward directions, but not sideways. Okay, So that is the literal meaning of this one. And thereafter, we have concluded as the result appears as E is equal to lambda by 2 pi epsilon naught R, E is inversely proportional to R. When R is increased from the, where what is R? R is nothing but its radius of our cylinder. R, it is nothing but the distance of between the axis of cylinder and the point of interest. If it is increased, then it becomes electric field becomes reduced. So electric field will be tending to zero when R tends to infinity. Electric field due to a charged sheet. That is, suppose if a charged sheet, suppose a sheet is being charged, and let's consider that it is acquiring some positive charge. Now I am interested to find this, the electric field due to the charged sheet. Here we write the charge density as sigma, which is equal to dq by ds, or charge per unit area. So this charge density is sigma. Now we have kept that, and then we wanted to know the electric field at a distance r. Now for this, how to find the electric field at this particular point P? Remember, now r is the distance from the charge sheet to the point of interest P. Now for this, the simplest Gaussian surface, again when I take Gaussian surface, immediately you must know it should pass through that particular point. Second, it is penetrating through this surface. Okay, so you can see this one. So this is positively charged sheet, and I wanted to know up to this point, at this point, that is the point here. This is my point of interest. Okay, now this is charged sheet. Now how do I imagine the Gaussian surface? I should cover up that point first, then it should be symmetrical for me. So I have taken one cylinder, and which is penetrating through this Gaussian surface. Okay, so within that cylinder, whatever the charge that is enclosed here, so this is Q in for it. Okay, is this clear? This is just symmetrical like this. This is charge sheet. At this point, I wanted to find the electric field. Therefore, I have imagined one Gaussian surface, and that Gaussian surface is penetrating through this charge sheet, and it appears like this. Again, we will have to investigate how many surfaces are there. Again, there are three surfaces. This is one surface. This is another surface. This is the third surface. Okay, so three surfaces, three area vectors. Now, what is the direction of the electric field at this particular point, as it is positive? If I keep any charge, positive charge here, it is being repelled. So therefore, the electric field for this, it is in this direction. Okay, for the curved surface also it is in this direction, but for this surface, as it is positively charged, and if I keep this one, this will be in the this direction. Now let us draw the directions here for you. So this is A1, outward normal. This is A2, outward normal for curved surface. Then this is A3. And if I imagine a positive charge here, then this is positive, therefore it ripples. So electric field vector for me, it is in this direction. Now for on the back side of this paper, if I imagine positive charge, so again it ripples, therefore I must write electric field direction in this. Once you get the directions, immediately we have to apply the Gauss law. What Gauss law tells us? E dot A1 plus E dot A2 plus E dot A3 should always be equal to 1 by epsilon naught times of Q enclosed within that surface. Now the first one, E and A1, the angle is 0, therefore E A1 cos 0. Now for the second surface, this is the area vector, this is electric field vector, therefore the angle is 90, therefore E A2 cos 90. And again third, E and area vector are in the same directions, therefore I must write E A3 cos 0. That is all equal to 1 by epsilon naught times of Q in. Now I can say that this is 0 because cos 90 is 0. Now here cos 0 1, A1 and A3 are, it is a symmetrical cylinder, therefore A1 and A3 must be having the A1 is equal to A3, which must be equal to pi r square. Okay, now listen here, this is the radius of the cylinder, so I must take some x, so or otherwise I can take some other letter, because you should not be confused with this r. Okay, so pi, let me write, small a is the radius of cylinder. Now what I can write? Pi a square. Of course A2 is equal to 2 pi length of the cylinder, that is 2r times a, but here that is, that contribution is 0, so we need not bother about it. So now what happens, the next step from this one, we can write it as e times pi a square plus e times, that is 0, second contribution is 0, and e times pi a square, which is equal to 1 by epsilon naught times of Q in. Now I can write this as 2e pi a square is equal to Q by epsilon naught, or I wanted to get E, therefore Q by 4 pi, I mean Q by this 2 pi will come here, 2 pi r square epsilon naught, but we know that Q by pi r square is sigma by 2 epsilon naught. So final, the answer The electric field at this point P from the charge sheet is turned out to be sigma by 2 epsilon naught. This is a wonderful result. Why it is wonderful? It is neither depending on the length of the cylinder, that is this radius, I mean the distance from which we are calculating the field, and nor on the radius of the cylinder. So sigma by 2 epsilon naught. So suppose, what does it indicate? Suppose somebody is here, for him also the electric field is sigma by 2 epsilon naught. For him, suppose if he moves away, for him also to sigma by 2 epsilon naught. Suppose if it is here, for him also the sigma by epsilon naught. In one of the textbooks, a nice analogy is given. What is that nice analogy? Suppose if you are standing in front of a wall and you are very close to the wall, then you can observe a small portion of area of the wall. So the charge lies in that portion per unit area is also very small. So Q by A is same. Therefore, you are the observer for that particular small portion of charge. Therefore, electric field is something. Now, when you move back, you can see large number of charges. Therefore, Q is increased, but at the same time, the surface that you can see is also increased. So, Q by A again remains constant. So, like that, when you go back, then you can see the entire wall. In fact, we have taken this as a very big sheet. These results are very much valid for infinite sheets, or otherwise it should be very large sheet. Otherwise what happens? Suppose if you take a smaller sheet, in that case when you go far off, the sheet appears to be a point charge. Now again in the point charge what happens? The electric field will be falling with R square. E is directly proportional to 1 by R square, because we know the formula E is equal to Q by 4 pi epsilon naught R square. So these results are valid only when we take the charge sheet is very big and the observer or the point of interest is very close to the very close to the charge sheet. So if somebody wants to draw a graph between this R, the distance, and electric field, what kind of graph do you expect for this one? It should be constant, therefore a straight line. So this is the answer for it. So electric field due to a charged sheet is this. Now we will talk about the corollary of this situation only. What is that? Suppose if I take one charge sheet which is having positive charge, and if I take another charge sheet which is also having the positive charge. Now these two charge sheets are dividing this region into three. Outside the second plate, inside are the between first and second plates, and outside the first plate. Now our aim is to calculate the electric field at this particular point. Now what should I do? First I have to take the contribution for this one. So here if I imagine positive charge, the electric field must be away from it. What it is due to first sheet, sigma A by 2 epsilon naught. Now due to second sheet, that will also be repelled because it is also positive. Therefore, what is that contribution? Sigma B by 2 epsilon naught. Now, what is the net field? E net is equal to sigma A plus sigma B by 2 epsilon naught. Now, here, if I wanted to note the electric field at this point, due to first charge sheet, it is in this direction. Due to second charge, again it is in this direction. Okay. Now, this is E1, this is E2. Superposition principle tells us E1 plus E2. So, again, sigma A plus sigma B by 2 epsilon naught. In this case, let's consider sigma A is greater than sigma B. Now, it is an interesting fact to discuss in between. Suppose if the positive charge is placed here, I wanted to notice the electric field. So then it repels, it also repels because both are positive. I made this vector smaller because I considered sigma A is more. So here the result will be sigma A minus sigma B. The net is in this direction only, finally. Sigma A minus sigma B by 2 epsilon naught. Now, what could be the special case here? Suppose if I take sigma A is equal to sigma B is equal to sigma. In that case, this result will be sigma by epsilon naught. This result will also be sigma by epsilon naught. And this result will be how much? Zero. So, the electric field between two positively charged sheets having same charge density is always zero. So, this is the simplest case. I could have done this activity whether the electric field is there or not. Anyway, when schools reopen, I'll show this activity. We can inspect whether really it works or not. Okay, so here this is one side, this is in between, and this is the other side. Now, if I take one as positive, the other one as negative, in that case, what happens? Here it will be, now let us discuss for the second case. I hope that you understood this one. So now let us talk about one is positive, the other one is negative, and we again consider sigma A is greater than sigma B. In this case, if I imagine positive charge here, then it is repelled sigma A by 2 epsilon naught, and this is attracted with this sigma B by 2 epsilon naught. As the two are in opposite directions, I should keep one negative sign here. And final resultant direction will be here only, E net. Now, the same is the case. Because of this, it goes. Because of this, it attracts. Remember, it does not depend on the distance. So, that is the beauty of this result. So, sigma A minus sigma B by 2 epsilon naught. Again, net will be in this direction. Now, what about the middle one? If I keep one positive charge, it repels. But the same positive charge will be attracted by it. So, therefore, E1 plus E2. So, just exactly what we got the earlier result, it is just opposite to that result. So, here, again, if you go through that case, sigma A is equal to sigma B is equal to sigma. This outside fields will be zeros and inside will be sigma by epsilon zero. So this is known as parallel plate capacitor. If you take two metal sheets and if they are given charges, then it acts like an energy storage device. That is only known as capacitor. you would have seen these white cylindrical capacitors in all fans. Okay, capacitors we will be talking about just 3 to 4 classes later, but this result we will be using in that case.